you know, I, in the interest of full disclosure, I want to just tell you how I met David, because it's kind of a funny story in a way that has an ending where I ended up losing something very dear to David's heart, and then he had no choice but to forgive me, and we became friends. David and I share a very dear friend in common named Dan Coughlin, who was the first producer of the show Democracy Now!, which is hosted by Amy Goodman, of course. And Dan gave me my first shot in journalism, even though I had no real resume to speak of. And Dan and David go back to childhood. And, you know, I was working for basically peanuts. Amy Goodman was paying me out of her pocket, you know, on the download to write news headlines in the morning. This is in the mid-90s at WBAI in New York. And I was struggling to figure out how to actually live in New York City. And David was at a moment in his life where he was contemplating his next project. He had done this wonderful film in the late 90s called La Ciudad, which hopefully will be updated to the modern times and released on Netflix so that a whole new generation of people can experience it. If you haven't heard of it, you should Google it, La Ciudad. It's an amazing film, and hopefully you'll be able to see it. But to make a long story short, David had this apartment in Soho that a political ally friend had given to him, and it was one of those arrangements that exists in New York City where rent was being paid in a particular way under the table for a place that was in a neighborhood.
I feel like I should interrupt this.
Anyway, to make a long story short, David was at a transitional point and basically gave me this amazing apartment. And so David had kept it for probably a decade or more. I lost it in less than a year by doing something stupid, and the super came in, and it was all over downhill from there. And then we've been friends ever since. but part of the reason why I'm so honored to be here, you know, I do war reporting and conflict reporting, and I spent a lot of time in Iraq, and I more recently was in Afghanistan and Somalia and Yemen. And David is someone that I've always admired and looked up to, but to be honest, we didn't know each other that well as of 2 years ago. And I was working on this project, this film called Dirty Wars, which will come out this summer. And Rick Rowley, who's a dear friend also, and I is the director of the film. He and I we thought we were done about a year and a half ago. And we went over to David's house, and I showed him some clips from it. And I said, you know, we'd really love if you would come to kind of look at the film and give us some feedback on the writing in the film. A year later, David had worked with us for the entire, you know, for the entire year plus. And completely reassembled this film, and it really now is a film that David and Rick and myself made together. And I really grew to admire, and I have to be honest, look up to David. And I think he's one of the most brilliant storytellers we have in our society. And the reason why this film is so important to me, and I've seen it a half a dozen times now, is because we live in this fast-paced media culture. Twitter, Facebook, and I love Twitter. I've met people in real life through Twitter that are dear friends now. But at some point, we all need to hit the pause button on our technology and back up and say, what does a real story look like? What does it mean to actually tell the story of people whose lives are affected by the decisions being made in the power-based capitals of the world? And David, to me, is an old-fashioned kind of guy who actually writes out long-form notes. And I don't know if David's using a typewriter, but I get notes from him that look like they were on a typewriter sometimes. And I think that it's a fading institution in our society. And this film for me is so revolutionary on so many levels because it turns a lot of the dialogue that we're having in our society upside down. And I really thank David for being a storyteller in a time of 140 character thoughts that are put out into the world. So I really admire you so much for that. And I think the first question I wanted to ask you, which may not be a conventional question at a lot of the talkbacks that you get, but you know, you're a very deep political guy. And you've made a film where the protagonist is a white woman from the United States. Or I mean, some could argue that Rosa is the protagonist, but the dominant perception might be that you've chosen to put a white woman as the protagonist in your film, which is about the politics and in a way the sort of depth of the experience of the border. So maybe you could talk about why you made that decision, because I think some people might think that's a controversial decision. Particularly given how deeply ingrained you are in some of these political movements and how much you know about the border.
Can I have 5 minutes just to think? Let me see this. Well, the starting point was my work in New York City in the 90s on the film The City, or La Ciudad. And it was an eye-opening experience for me to begin to understand the experience of newly uprooted immigrants in a way that was made very real to me because of the close friendships I made. But I was angered by all of the stories I heard. And it shook my world upside down. The fact that almost every immigrant that I spend time with in New York City had to leave their children behind when they came to this country. And most were parents, young parents, but parents. I remember vividly a man in Queens sitting down in a cafe with me and saying, "I want to show you a picture of my daughter." And he put a little thumbnail, you know, photo of this little girl who looked maybe 4 years old on the cafe. And I picked it up and said, "Oh my God, Cesar, she's beautiful." And before I could say anything else, he pulled another one out and put it beside it. And this girl was maybe 6. And then he put another one, and she was perhaps 9. And another, she was 11. And another, she was 15. Another. And he said, "I've never seen her since I left." You know, he's watched his daughter grow up through thumbnail photographs. And I was furious. And that anger sort of gave me the energy to try and make that film. And I should make this a shorter version. I always get distracted, you know. Because you're asking about an Anglo character. Well, making that film, really, I made a decision in that film that I didn't want the Anglo guide. You know, we've seen these films so many times where a white, usually it's a man, kind of sympathetic guy, takes us into the conflict zone.
We call it the magic cracker.
The magic cracker. I did not want a magic cracker, and so that film, I didn't even speak Spanish. I had to learn Spanish to make the film, but I did want no magic crackers. I wanted just to be thrown into that world and to try as much as possible to have their voices and their feelings shape the film. All of the actors in that film, almost all, were non-actors. They were garment workers and day laborers, and they all told me stories of crossing the border. And so I went down to the border when I was done with it to write a script about the border. I really thought I'd learned so much making La Ciudad that I could do it in 6 months. And that was over 10 years ago. And why? What happened? And why did I end up with an Anglo character when I went down to have a Latino migrant at the center of the story? What happened is I realized all of my preconceptions were false. I went down to the border with all these ideas, the ideas that came to me from where? They exist in the world we live in. And the main one, the dominant idea about the border can be reduced to this. Hope is on this side of the border. This is where it's at. And south of the border, God forbid that's where you're from. You know, if you can just get to the north, we know we're all in New York City. If it wasn't true, we would all be down on the border trying to get into Mexico. But it's not that way. People are coming north. Therefore, hope must be in the north. But I know from my work over the last 2 decades and my travels around the country that all over the place, there are people who are really trapped or feel shut out from this quote-unquote great American dream. And on the south of the border, on the Mexican side, I also know that it's not a place filled with despair. So the myth itself was inadequate. Then I was confronted by the deaths on the border. All the length of the border, we have stories of hundreds and now thousands of people who have died trying to cross the desert, the river. And I ask myself, who's responsible for these deaths? It's a complicated question. And it's a complicated calculation every person makes when they leave their home to come north. But what isn't complicated is that they are coming north to work and that they're coming to work for us. Or let me say for us, for me and my family. I don't want everyone to feel implicated, but definitely coming here to work for us. And if they're coming here to work for us, then somehow I'm a part of it. And the question I realized is not why is the Anglo character in the center of this migration or border drama, but why has the Anglo character always been invisible? Right? It's never there. We see so many films that tell the story of the sacrifice of the migrant to make it, to leave home, to get across the border, and we are absent, as if it had nothing to do with us. I wanted to take an American and put that person right in the dramatic center of this story. A woman who takes no responsibility for her actions and force her to confront that fact. Does that make sense? Yeah. That's why I ended up, that's also why I didn't have any white hair when I started this, by the way. It took me a long time to figure out that I wanted to kind of turn the border upside down and turn those ideas or try and turn them upside down.
I want to open it up in a second, but one other question. I mean, I know because because we've been working together for a long time now, and I've seen the film several times, but the girl, the young girl, Maritza Santiago, first of all, she's amazing. I mean, what an incredible person. But I think people might be surprised to know, you know, she's not a professional actor. She hadn't done this before. To cut a long story short, you spent years looking for a girl to play that role, and you had originally had someone else, and when the economy imploded, she had already gone through puberty and became too old to actually play the role, so you had to start over. I mean, it's an interesting challenge of filmmakers. But I actually wanted to ask you a little bit more of a complicated question, and I mean, we didn't discuss this at all, but it's something that I've wondered now that I've seen it a few times. I see the Abby character, Abby Cornish's character. Abby Cornish, the other night in a Q&A that I was at, said, sort of gave a happy ending to what she thinks happens with the Abby character. I sort of read it a little bit differently, and I'm not going to ask you how you think it goes after the film. If someone else wants to get into that, maybe. But I saw it as, this is a person who was responsible for the death of this young girl's mother. And the girl had and the grandmother have this incredible sense of forgiveness. They, you know, when the grandmother says the river took her, not, you know, you didn't take her, the river took her. I'm not so convinced that it's all a happy ending for Abby, because I think there's for Ashley in the film, because I think there's a realization of what she's done, and I think that's a good question to have debated at the end of someone's film, is what happens next, because it means you've reached the viewer. But I'm wondering what the personal experience was for you with Maritza Santiago, the girl who played Rosa, and how much she understood the story that was being told. And I'm sure, I mean, I know, because I love children and spend a lot of time around children, I know that kids are much smarter than a lot of adults give them credit for. And what the experience was, because you trained her to be an actor, which is an amazing story, but you also got to know her as a person. So what was her read on the story you guys were telling and that she was a major character in?
Yeah, Maritza. Can I ask how people responded to Maritza? Because I wasn't here really to experience the film with you, but did you? Yeah, Maritza is a little force of nature. I said this story last night that I saw thousands of girls. I started losing my mind. I had two little daughters who eventually, my older daughter said, "Daddy, I see you're so sad, you can't find a girl. I will be Rosa for you." And she looks like a pale Irish girl.
Who speaks fluent Oaxaca Spanish.
We moved to Oaxaca and spent 6 years there.
Oh.
And I'm sad to say I've moved back, but happy that it's with the film. So I spent years looking for Maritza, and the search is there. I knew that she needed to be a little girl, but very, very strong, like had the strength of an adult. And in fact, she had to be strong enough to be the motor force, the driving force for the drama. Without her, Ashley, would never go on this journey. You know, the girl had to be strong enough to push her on the journey. So a little girl with this towering strength, but she also needed to be from the indigenous culture of Oaxaca, from the villages of Oaxaca. And for reasons that are probably obvious, after the long history of colonialism, these indigenous communities are very protective, for good reason. You know, they certainly don't want someone who looks like me to come in and say, "Bring out your little girls and let me take your daughter to the border for 6 months." You know, the whole proposition was a disaster. And I realized I had to start much earlier. I had to come in and say, "Can I tell you who I am? And I had to do this. I know that I had more than 1,000 meetings over the course of several years with committees of parents, with school directors, with parents, with teachers groups, and over that time met an endless number of girls. But most of them, when their faces were right for the film, were too shy to even speak. When I met Maritza the first day, she looked at me and she said, "Do you work for the circus? Are you with the circus?"
I've asked you that same question.
Because I'm so enormous, you know, and my hair was long, and she was just I felt, you know, when you're looking for a non-actor, what does it mean to work with non-actors? Yeah, it means you're not looking for someone to act the role. You're really looking for someone who is that character. In this case, I was looking for Rosa. You remember the film Bicycle Thieves? You know, the lead actor in that was an unemployed worker. And that film was a grounding for me as a young wannabe filmmaker. But I had learned that the story behind that man, that after the film came out, it was a tremendous success. He wanted to act again. Did you know this? He wanted to be in a star. And nobody would hire him. Because he couldn't be, he wasn't an actor. He was just that man. And he became an alcoholic. And his life ended very, very tragically. And I have always kept that in mind, that you have such a responsibility as a filmmaker, and that you're going into someone's life, someone's home, someone's community, and you're going to turn it upside down for a period. And you need to be looking in the far distance to see what does the outcome look like. Can the girl at the end of this film actually be stronger and more grounded than she is when you met her? What would that mean? And so that wasn't your question, but in terms of her awareness and understanding, every family in Oaxaca understands migration. The total population of the state is 3 million. 1 million Oaxacans are in California.
Oh, wow.
And another million are in Oaxaca City now. It means that the villages have lost 2/3 of their population. And so for our girl, the only thing that would cause Maritza to cry, because she's generally a very bubbly girl, is when she talks about the time that her father left and was gone for 2 years. And you just have to mention it and she starts to cry.
He had gone to the United States?
He never made it to the United States, but he ended up working away from Oaxaca for 2 years. Many of the girls' fathers were in the United States when I met them. And in fact, the grandmother in the village, all of her children but one are in the U.S., and she just never sees them. And I, you know, this seems like a friendly place. You know, I want to abolish the border. What do I mean by that? I mean, I don't think it's right that I can live in the United States and on a daily basis enjoy the contributions of undocumented immigrants. Every time I go to a restaurant or I get a cup of coffee or there's a leak and someone comes to fix it, or my children need to be taken care of, or my parents do in hospital, it's immigrant workers that are taking care of them. And therefore I am already supporting that. But I cannot allow myself to support their condition as second-class citizens in this kind of shadow economy. So I decided with La Ciudad, I really was careful with La Ciudad not to ever say anything like this. But I can't be silent anymore. I really see the contradiction, and this film is the result of my grappling with that. Ashley is me, you know. I wanted to put myself in that place, that uncomfortable place. Jeremy says, it's, you know, I don't know if you said it's clear, but Ashley is responsible for this mother's death. Well, we could debate that, right? Did she force them across the river? I know she says, when they protest that there's no inner tubes, she says, "If you want me to take you back to the plaza, I will." Do you remember that? And what do? They start to undress. Who is really responsible? But of course she is responsible. And for me, the whole film is about her just coming to the point of starting to take responsibility, which is...
Yeah, yeah.
Well, we'll open it up now. I'd be very curious to hear what people think, or if you have a question or a comment. I know David is really happy to listen to anything anyone has to say.